Come and find me. I'm always in the back eating the leftover food, and I need new friends. I have beautiful business cards. I love to hand them out. Come and meet me. And tonight is very special, not only because it's the first bailout of the new year, but also because our artist tonight is usually behind the scenes, making all of the art happen, and tonight he is the main event. So, please give a warm round of applause to our potential prophet for the evening, Zach Mosley!
That was Christmas Wrappings by Al Carmines, recorded in 1960-something, I'm not sure. Welcome to 2019. the first bailout of 2019. That song, I think it makes me cry about one about one in four plays. And I'm not that interested. I'm never been a big like Virgin Mary reverent person or anything like that. Nothing about the context of the song or anything like that. It's kind of like one of those commercials. If you've ever, you know, had a tough year or something like that, and like some really cheesy tampon commercial makes you just burst into tears. And one in four plays, that song, it does it for me every time. So when I was setting up, I would play it to get hyped up in the space. It's all about like Judson and Christmas tradition and all of these sort of baked in things we got going on. And so I put the whole album on. And I was like, you know what? I'm gonna listen to Christmas rappings while I set this up, and I'll get super Christmas hyped. And I had to turn it off. It's right about it'll get on your nerves too, you know. And Hail Mary, full of grace, full of grace. I was just like, no, I cannot do that while I'm working in this space. So, bailout was started relative to the 2008 financial crisis, as a program to welcome people in who are food insecure, but not used to being food insecure. And they just showed movies on the wall, like just anything, like The Labyrinth or, Star Wars, anything like that, and got food from local businesses. And just fed people who needed it and gave them a place to hang out. And things really brewed up, you know, there was Occupy and things got heavy there for a while before they got heavy again. I mean, the Iraq War, there were crowds of people in here with fists in the air every week getting down during that period. And it seemed so heavy, but kind of doesn't now, you know, in the Trump era, heaviness, the line has changed. So I wanted to give an explanation of the program and a little context. And every year we dispose of the Christmas trees and the Christmas decor. There's a lot of it. There's less than there used to be. They used to put like four trees on each side of the stage. And Bill Stabile would do these amazing decorations. Some of them are still in the mix tonight in the room. And it was a lot to clean up. There's less now. Now I think it's just one big tree. Wreathelbeam brings one big tree. And that sort of carries the day for now. But yearly, I'm sort of thinking about the program. Okay, sorry, get back there. So it evolved. A young minister took it over, Mike Abusey, and he decided to bring in live art, you know, and understood the history of the space and was like, forget a stale old movie. Let's invite artists to perform and keep feeding people. And what I've noticed through working the program, and anytime I do any work, I want it to be true to life to the program and not use any house advantage. The fact that I work here and I know the space better than anybody, to like leverage that to be a show off, I kind of want to do things that I do anywhere. You know what I mean? So I look really closely at the program and try to feel and act like an artist would coming from the outside. And I really agonized about what to do with the bailout and deeply regretted it. You know, I mean, they begged me to take the date and I finally relented.
But the one most notable thing about it is or one of my favorite things about Micah and his approach is the story of oftentimes not reading scripts. The idea is he's looking for what the individual, why they need to perform somewhere. And like what they're going through and what they're trying to accomplish, it's not about the content of the work necessarily. And I found that really troubling because it requires a vulnerability, which is, I mean, you know, you're seeing people here often at the program who may almost never perform and are really just really putting themselves out there. And yeah, I just fucking hate that. That is not a fun thing to do, and I deeply regret it. All right. Yeah, I think that's it.
It has been called the Day of Days. It is a time of magic, pageantry, warmth, generosity, and love. For many of us, our fondest childhood memories revolve around the traditions of Christmas that many around the world celebrate as the birth of Jesus Christ,
the Savior and Messiah of mankind.
In reading and crass commercialism, have you ever wondered why we decorate the Christmas tree? Why we light the Yule log? Why we hang the mistletoe? And why we teach our children to believe in Santa Claus? A large single log considered to be a phallic idol was lit on fire and kept burning for 12 days. Chances are, you'll never look at Christmas the same ever again.
Joys and concerns. I have a lot to be grateful for. Both in my family and my friends and Judson, and it has been a strangely tough year in that general vibe sense, and you guys, are all aware of it through Trump and the political circumstance, and it just seems like something dark is afoot in a way that it hasn't been in the past. And with having a kid, you worry more about the future, and I don't think the poinsettias are very straight. And let's see.
Now, most of us already know what this holiday means to the occult, is that we're seeing upside down Christmas trees. But remember, they do things in reverse. They do things upside down. We know that they use symbols and revert them upside down. We know that they use the upside down cross being inverted, right? We're seeing Christianity, which once was considered the normal, respectful way to live, following God's law is a good thing. Now we're seeing a society where everybody has turned on God. Everyone thinks God is selfish and God is hateful, and that all Christians except for bigots, and being, this or that, identifying yourself as a Christmas wreath. Right?
The sun god had now become the birth date of the Son of God. Christ's mass had reached a fevered pitch. Common practices included open sex in the streets, rioting, murder,
making the Christmas tree. Every year. It is one of my favorite things about Christmas.
Me too. But I have always wanted to know why we keep a Christmas tree at home during Christmas.
I don't know. But let's go ask the professor.
People first started keeping Christmas trees over 500 years ago in Germany. When people from Germany moved to America, they continued to keep the Christmas tree at home. This practice caught on with...
This stone becomes bread.
Man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.
If God loves you, throw yourself down. His angels will lift you up in their hands.
I wasn't sure I was really going to lie on the piano, but I figures like you want to give people's attention. I wish I could do this. You know, there's nothing like just pulling a grand piano right down in front of their face and lying on it. You know what I mean? To really just say, I have something to say. But no, this is Oliver who I'm portraying. I need to not say that for the moment, but he does this thing here and there where he just turns on this total adult inflection. And I don't know where he gets it from. We don't do that thing where you, you know, try to teach a young person to act like an adult, or you know, let him watch adult programs, or like any of that stuff. And so he told me, he's like, and this is what he does. He leans like this on the bed. He's like, you know, Dad, people talk a lot about Jesus. And I was like, okay, as you know, Fox News type of thing people say. I was like, who specifically is saying what? You know, Dad, people talk a lot about Jesus. So I was like, Lady of Pompeii, because that's a Catholic school he went to for a year from 2 to 3. And which makes perfect sense, because they totally did talk a lot about that. And he's like, no. And I was like, Andy goes to Sunday school. I was like, Sunday school teachers. He's like, no, which makes sense. Like, because you can go to a whole year of sermons here, and maybe hear the word Jesus 3 times, strangely enough. He's like, no. He's like, you know, Dad, people talk a lot about Jesus, but I think it's really boring. And, you know, I'm not a deeply practicing Christian or anything like that. So, I'm not out to maybe modulate him a little bit or anything, but I might. And I used to, when people would ask me what I do for a living, say I work for a church, but then I'd throw in all these qualifiers, like, I work for a church, but I'm an atheist, but it's a really cool church, it's like social justice committed, and like anybody can go there, and you know, it's like here, it's queer, it's like everything you need to be comfortable for a church is where I work, but it's a church type of thing. But I don't do that these days. I just look them dead in the eye and I say, I work for a church. And let them imagine all the worst altar calls they can. And that seems to work for me. And I kind of did the same thing with him. It's like, it is boring. I just told him it is. And I don't know where he got it. But as I was, you know, looking up videos, people do. They do talk a lot about Jesus, so that's a real thing. So I started writing, and I wrote a Bible. Started writing a Bible for you know who. This was the intro to that, basically, like a few verses. Oliver's Bible. Chapter 1, Origins.
No.
We're pretty loose
out
here. Hit escape.
The Great Unknowable.
And start that over. I mean, it's the beginning of the damn
Before
Bible.
Before anything,
like, gotta have
there was the nothing. And it was part of the Great Unknowable. The nothing was quiet because there was no sound. The nothing was dark because there was no light. The nothing was empty because there were no things. The nothing, because it had no sound or light or things, could simply be nothing, and that was good. The nothing liked the quiet darkness and was content. Now, somewhere around the nothing, there might have been something in the Great Unknowable. There may be many nothings and many somethings in the Great Unknowable, or only one of each, or different kinds of nothings and somethings. There is no way to know, and that is why it's called the Great Unknowable. As long as the somethings and nothings and the Great Unknowable are apart, the nothing can remain nothing, and the something can remain something. If the nothing and a something come into contact, it's a big deal, and anything and everything happens. At some point long ago, our nothing met a something in the Great Unknowable, and now we can look around and see that anything and everything is in fact happening, and it is good. When the nothing met the something, suddenly there was a big bang, and it was incredible. The something filled the nothing with bright and colorful lights, powerful forces, and many, many, many things. The nothing filled the something with great space, vast darkness, and quiet. This developed into a big, dark, and quiet space full of little somethings with bright lights and great energies going forth around them, and it was truly awesome. When something and nothing intermingle in the Great Unknowable, they devise strategies. Nothing wants to take the place of something, and something wants to take the place of nothing, and they go back and forth and on in ever intricate patterns. As those patterns get more complicated, much is formed. Oceans sway back and forth with the motion of the moon. Light inhabits the day and darkness the night. Mountains soar and crumble of energy, and the sky forms clouds of weather with great forces. This formed a soup where anything and everything could happen, and so it did. Observers were born. Through great sensation, they could feel the warmth of the light and the cold of the dark, and they moved among them back and forth. The result was every man.
After this, Mary rose and went with great haste up into the hill country to visit with her cousin Elizabeth, wife of Zacharias. And when Elizabeth saw Mary and heard her speaking, the babe leaped in her womb and she cried out,
"Blessed, blessed, blessed art thou among women. Blessed, blessed, blessed art thou among women. Blessed is the fruit of
I think you're still rolling on me.